Joe, we were just talking there about, you know, we're exactly the same age almost within a couple of weeks of each other. Mm-hmm. And I grew up in a small town in Ireland and you grew up where you did. And I'm just wondering, you know, what music you were listening to and what music I probably missed while you were doing that.
No, I didn't miss it. I mean, I listened to classics. I lived in the suburbs, so I listened to, the Who. And I got into AC/DC, and that was our alternative, band. They thought I was crazy when I had the AC/DC shirt. Like, ooh, that guy's different. It's like, it's AC/DC. It's good stuff.
That's pretty much similar to what we were listening to over here at that same time. It's exactly what we were listening to. But I sometimes wonder, you know, what you might have heard that pushed you into exploring music more.
Well, Velvet Underground and probably the Violet Femmes. You know, the simplicity, it when you hear something that simple, it's like, yeah, you can do this.
And in terms of guitar, you were listening clearly to more than just Pete Townshend or Jimi Hendrix or so on. You must have been listening to other types of guitar players.
Oh, there was, we had a public library, so I just explored music, like, you know, Montgomery, Joe Pass.
So all the jazz players?
Kind of, yeah. I liked Wes Montgomery for his, like, octaves.
And what were you getting from that? Because, I mean, again, we had the public library. I took all those records out as well, but a lot of my pals just weren't interested at all, for instance, in jazz or old blues records.
Oh, you weren't?
Well, I was, but my pals weren't. Nobody else was. I was kind of a freak in that I was listening to this stuff.
Well, I guess I listened to it because our the record stores that we had, you know, didn't have it. You know, didn't have a good selection of those. So I would listen to those and I already had the Who, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles, you know what I mean? So I'm not going to go to the library and, like, get rock and roll.
And what appealed to you in, for instance, what a jazz guitarist was doing? Because it seemed incredibly alien the first time I heard it.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't know what they were at.
That's what it is, alien.
Yeah.
You know, something very different than that. You know, I'm still into them. Anything by Art Blakey is good, you know, to me. Yeah. It's groovy, you know. And,
well, let's bring the drummer in at that point, because you've got a dark and murky musical history as well. You were into a band that we all kind of had to disown, and that's Rush.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, for some reason, it wasn't part of the zeitgeist, was it? I mean, that's what punk was against. You know, Rush were probably typical of the sort of band that when you became a punk, we couldn't really like that anymore.
Then he's a real punk.
Exactly.
You know, punks were punks because they were different. This guy's different. He liked Rush.
Rush, I mean, the musicianship was stunning.
Well, that's primarily why I liked Rush and why I'm into them. It's just for three guys, they're experts. The musicianship is just is unheralded, and to write that kind of weird music to go along with it, the time tempos and stuff like that, it attracted me as drummer, especially the drummer, but the bass playing and of course the guitar playing there, I just admired that.
Well, what Neil Peart did on the drums in Rush, it is extraordinary. None of us had ever heard anything like that. Because again, at that stage, I probably hadn't heard jazz drummers, but first rock and roll band doing this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But again, you know, if you were wanting to join a punk band at that time, all that stuff that Neil Peart did, on the face of it, doesn't seem to be very useful.
Yeah, well, it's funny because when we first started the Pixies, I was busy as hell. I mean, like that. And I realized soon enough that I can't do this. So that I was a conscious effort that I kind of toned down. And it's taken me, 20, 30 years now. I think I finally got it down now enough that it's not crazy.
And yet you, Joe, as a guitar player, were able to bring everything in.
You know, something about Rush, too, in every music magazine back then, like, rated bass player, it's the guy from Rush. Yeah. Best guitar player, the guy from Rush. And then you know, Alex.
Alex Lifeson.
And then
Kurt. But the point was, you couldn't copy it, though. That's the thing. If you formed a little three-piece band in your school, the chances of being able to play Rush music was impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the guys I knew, we couldn't play it anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I think when I listen to Rush, I go like, I don't want to start a band.
Yeah, so when you did start a band, what was your kind of, if you had one, manifesto as such? I mean, what were you setting out to do or indeed not do?
That was the only reason why I went to the university was to start a band. You know, and Charles did the same thing. And then luckily we were in the same suite. So, you know, it was just kismet, you know. And then we wanted to get the hell out of there after a while. It was, you know, the college life started getting boring.
But yeah. Musically, you know, a lot of bands when they start, they want to be part of what's going on, what the zeitgeist is, and there's often an element of affectation in it as well. You know, you want to be what doing what all the cool kids are doing. Mm-hmm. But you guys seem to be following some route of your own that you'd figured out.
Yeah, I don't think we had a plan. It was just this is what it became.
Yeah.
Again, I answered an ad. I hadn't played drums in years, but it was something about, you know, oh wow, this would be fine to be in a band, it'd be fun to do. And there was no formula or nothing. We just started doing gigs and just around Boston. And
well, for instance, in your first gigs in Boston, would you have been doing a lot of covers? I'm just curious to know what kind of band. So no covers at all.
Nah.
Straight into your own stuff.
Yeah.
Nah.
We had enough just to do, I think our first gig was, what, half an hour or something?
Yeah, I think we did one cover, 500 Miles, by Peter, Paul, and Mary. You know, I told Charles, like, you know, if we're going to, like, go out, let's go out in the distance, 500 Miles.
Yeah. Nobody would have seen that coming, I'd imagine. And this was in Cambridge, Massachusetts.
Cambridge was the first gig, place called Jack's, which is probably no longer there. But
it burnt down.
Oh, okay. But it was a Wednesday night, and we were advertised as the Puxies, Puxies. So,
right. So there was no particular ethos, or you know, we want to sound like this, or we definitely don't want to sound like this, or we're not playing these kinds of chords, right? None of that. That's great. Yeah. But in terms of the chords, Joe, that you were bringing into it, do you know where they were coming from?
The chords?
The chords, yeah.
No. The chords is, that's Charles. That's part of the songwriting process.
No, but some of these must be yours, aren't they?
Nah.
No?
Well, I mean, sometimes I would do that Jimi Hendrix chord.
Yeah.
It's in like three or four songs.
Yeah.
And one of the songs, it's like I featured it on the beginning of Is She Weird? Ding, ding,
ding, ding. But those,
you know, it's like a mysterious chord.
He's not here, so we can talk about that process a little bit. I have a friend who's a musician, and he was playing Gigantic on the piano, and he said a normal band would play it like this, and it was a very nice pop song.
Mm-hmm.
He said, but these guys, Pixies, they play this chord, and he said it becomes Stravinsky. Those are the words he used. So I'm just wondering where that sort of strange approach comes from. I always thought it was you, Joe, but you're saying it's Charles.
Yeah, it's Charles. Those are just normal chords too. You know, there's normal. There's a push on it that makes it. But
the sounds are clearly yours. The sounds that at the time we hadn't heard before.
Oh, the sonic stuff. Yeah, it's due to just being a limited. You know, I got lucky, you know, it's like, I can't do that. I don't want to do that. My influence are like, it's deductive.
Yeah.
You know, I don't go, oh, I want to be like that guy. You go, that, you know, it's like, that guy's that guy. So, I, you know, it's like, that's his job.
But you must have been picking up tricks from people as you listened. You know, how does Hendrix do that? How does such and such a
band do that? Hendrix does a double note, the things I do. But, you know, I just exploited the hell out of it.
And George Harrison, actually, I read, was a big influence on you as well.
The arpeggios.
Yeah.
And he's just in the pocket. He's not in the way, you know, but it is interesting, you know.
When people talk, David, about the dynamics of Pixies, they always talk about this quiet, loud thing. Was that something the band came up with, or was that driven by you, by the drummer?
No, I think that no one thought, I don't think there was any plan or formula. It just, that's what became, or
yeah.
I don't think we never used it as a formula or anything. It just happened. And that's what some of the songs sound like.
Yeah.
Well, I want to talk about the new album in just a second, but I'm very curious, David, about what you've been doing in the intervening years. You've been working as a magician.
Ah, correct.
Right. Now, I don't meet many magicians. Is there any connection at all between being a magician and a musician, apart from performance, obviously? Is there anything intellectually connecting the two?
Oh gosh. Other than the spelling of US and AG, I think that's the only connection. I think that the two, it's funny, when I, in the Pixies, we could be playing, you know, in front of just what we did in Marley Park yesterday. It was a lot of people. I'm behind a drum set, I'm not nervous, I've never been nervous, it's very easy to do. When I did my first Magic show, I was in front of maybe 8 people. I sweat so much and shook so much, it was scary. So that's one thing that I noted. It was interesting, you know, being behind a drum set and with some people that I'm sharing the stage with. I don't get nervous. It's very easy to be a part of the whole thing going on. But when I'm doing my own thing, when I first started, it was very scary.
And what was the attraction in it for you, David? Because, you know, a lot of people, you know, you get in a, I'm not saying it's a comfort zone, but you're doing, when you're drumming with a band, you know exactly what you're doing. But to you know, to take that leap and then do something where you are exposed, yeah. A lot of people wouldn't do that.
It was more so I saw a magic trick that blew me away, and I had to figure out how it was done. And that began an obsession. And most everything I do, I'll just obsess over and do it until I master it. And that was just another thing of magic. I slept with a deck of cards. I mean, I did it for a number of years. And one thing I can say about magic that it did is it gave me confidence. I might not have been the most confident person, even with the Pixies, you know, playing behind there. That was the nervousness of doing something on my own. But being a magician and going on and doing tricks in front of people and stuff like that, it builds your confidence up. And that was just, that's immeasurable for me for what magic has given me.
And a lot of your magic acting.
I should take it up.
Never too late.
I got zero confidence.
You said that before, actually. You're never comfortable getting up and playing. You know, you're always.
Yeah.
Would many musicians?
I'm afraid of people. like a crowd.
I don't blame you there. But would many musicians be like that and maybe just be able to disguise it somehow? You know, you see guitarists up there; they look so cool and together. You know.
I think generally they're shy people, aren't they?
Yeah.
You know. Bono actually told me, he lives up there, right, in that roof? Bono actually told me, I told him, like, oh man, I'm really, he commented on my guitar playing. I go, God, no, you know, why? You know, and he actually said, like, the edge is just like that. You guys are so self-deprecating. I don't know why you guys are like that, you know? I mean, me and maybe him or anyone else, you know? You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, when you start...
We're the first one to off ourselves.
but when you're talking about nerves, does that mean literally when you're walking out in front of a crowd, it's exclusive. Do you shake? Do you get sick? Do you, you know, just butterflies in the stomach?
I threw up at the Reading when we were headlining it. Yeah.
But when you get on stage, I presume that goes, does it?
Oh yeah, it goes away. Now it goes away. Now I'm just concentrating on chords and, you know, I look at my shoelaces. I try not to. That's why I wear Chelsea's now, you know, so I don't have shoelaces to.
Well, let's talk about the new album for a minute. Without getting into all the bad stuff, and I'm sure there was lots of it, it must be awful when a band splits up. Because you're a bunch of friends, really. I know people fight and all that, but a band is always a gang. And, you know, when you thought it was all over, it must leave a massive hole in your life.
Oh yeah, it was. It was shocking. And it was something that I knew and I loved and I wanted to do was playing mm-hmm. in the Pixies, and it had just gone away. Yeah. So it was a tough thing, and I didn't know what to do at that point. I was really kind of lost. But time went on and things happened, and I would have never, ever, ever dreamed we would have got back together. Mm-hmm. So when we did, it was like, what? You know, yeah. That was amazing in itself. So
when we were breaking up, there was one thought in my mind. No one was appreciating it. We're just like, I thought we were like a bunch of pricks, you know, like unappreciative idiots. It's like we're doing the best thing, and then we broke it up. No one was ever happy. I mean, Dave wasn't happy, but I was unhappy because everyone else was kind of like that. You know, it's like, what is there to be? We're fucking traveling. I mean, we're doing what we wanted to do, you know? And then all of a sudden it's like, what happened? You know, we were dead, you know, we were all, why would you pick up an instrument? You know, why would you get an amp? It's so loud, You know, it's not, you're not going to stay in the bedroom anymore. You're committed to playing in front of people. Yeah. Right when you get this loud thing, you know, and I don't know, then you finally make it, and then, you know, fucking, you just, you know, I don't want to do this anymore, whatever happened, you know, but it happens. Every band has a shelf life anyways. You know, it's a difficult dynamic.
You've done various musical projects since that, but the thing is, of course, like any band, like you mentioned the Velvet Underground earlier on, to be a good example of it, you're always, you know, you're the only guys who are going to sound like Pixies. You know, no, people can try all they like, but it has to be this setup. It has to be, you have to be the drummer and you have to play guitar, you know, for it to work, for it to happen. And even when you've done covers of other people's music, it's still Pixies,
yeah.
You know. So you can't, there's no way of replacing that.
I don't know, I think, I don't know who said it, Charles or me, I was like, we make about the pizza. That's what all we do. We don't, you know, it's round, but we don't make cookies, you know. It's, you know.
Okay.
We like this. We like going like this.
So the album then, when you came to make this record, the current Indie Cindy, when you got back together again to make this record, was it difficult, or do you just fall back into position and just, you know, pick up where you left off? Because with friends that often happens. You don't see friends for 50 years and you just pick up the conversation.
Yeah, it was just like riding a bike. It was just like what we've done before in the studio. There was nothing new about it. The only difference was the medium. We were using digital instead of an analog tape machine, but it was the same old, same old. Mm. Very comfortable and just boom, just do the work.
And what about other changes that had happened in the intervening years in terms of things you might be able to do on guitar with technology, drums and loops and all that? Did you want to bring that sort of stuff into what you, you know, things you couldn't do then that you could do now?
Maybe subconsciously, right? That we were screwed either way, you know. Oh man, they did it again. They sound like whatever, you know. Why do they do that? Why do they copy themselves? You know, other bands can do it, but we you know, I don't think we, but we could either do that or explore new territory. So it, given a choice, we would rather go somewhere else. For the first release anyways.
Yeah.
The second one, we're gonna sound like, what do you want to sound like, Dave?
Rush.
Surferosa or, Surferosa or Bossa Nova?
I like Surferosa. Yeah.
Okay, so we'll sound like Surferosa.
It's interesting for me because, I mean, as I said earlier, we're the same age, and I'm now a lot older and know more about music than I did when I first heard your album. So I can hear now what you're doing. I can hear Link Ray, you know, and I can hear, you know, that one of the tracks sounds kind of like a James Bond theme, one of them, and there's another one which AC/DC could do, or to go back to Boston, Aerosmith could do it as well. But, you know, I can hear all sorts of stuff in there that at the time I wouldn't have been aware of, you know. So your roots are showing on this album, I think.
It's very descriptive, huh? Surf music.
Yeah, well, that's what it is.
It's like the chicken and the egg. Which came first, the title or the music? You know, they probably listen to music and go, you know, that sounds like a Run Chicken Run, or that sounds like a Rumble.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. It's like, I'm going to make a song that sounds like the Rumble. Or just like, maybe he, you know, he made it first and he goes like, I see it. I see the Rumble.
But then who is, if there's only one, who's the pop guy in the group? You know, the one with the real pop sensibility, because there's some real stonking pop songs in this new album. You know, that a kind of an ordinary pop band could have a nice pop hit with, if you know what I mean.
Raise your hands in three.
Who is that?
One, two, three. Two.
It's you, is it? It's all of you. Right?
It's probably all of us.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, in terms of, let's say, pop music, as opposed to what we call the cool stuff, you know, you can talk about Link Ray and surf music and all that, that's mm-hmm. terrific. But what kind of pop music, in that pure pop sense, do you listen to? Because it's pretty evident on the album, I think.
I love pop. I listen to pop music or contemporary, top 40 or whatever. Some of it I don't like, but a genuine, really good pop song, I mean, you can't beat it.
No.
A good song is a good song. Yeah. Like, talking about, what the hell song is that? Oh, we're talking about Katy Perry.
Yeah? You like Katy Perry?
Well, I'm taking my daughter there. A good song is a good song.
Yeah.
Here comes a name drop. Watch this. I had dinner with Slash in Stockholm, and we talked about Katy Perry, like our kids like it. And I go, oh, and so now, you know, what the hell is a good song? It's a good song. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, this is a gate.
I hope it isn't.
It's a gate, you know?
Yeah.
A good gate.
And has this been a pleasure for you? Because I hope it has been. Has this whole making this album, has it been a pleasure? Has it been a good thing?
Yes, I think so. I mean, for myself, I got to say that every record that we've done, the Pixies, except for the first one, I've hated going in the studio. Never liked it. And the only reason was because these albums were happening quicker and quicker and quicker. Where I like to be a perfectionist and get everything right and be very comfortable with everything. And it was very tough to be in that position because we were doing these records so fast.
Did you make Surfer Rosa in a week or something?
Yeah, well, I think we did it in 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks, that whole thing. But again, those songs we had played around Boston. We had gigged with them as well as they were pretty fresh with us, or we knew them. Every album after that became a little tougher, really, to get it down and be very happy with it. I'm very happy with what we did, but it was always like 2 months into the road, it was like, oh yeah. I feel this maybe a little better. But this one, Indy Cindy, we had worked on a long time. We had thrown the songs back and forth. I learned them in and out. I got very comfortable with it. So going into the studio was a pure joy this time for me, and I just enjoyed everything. It just worked hard. It was wonderful.
David, Joe, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you, Joe.
Thanks, Dave. Thank you.
Thank you.